Thank you, Barbara. It's a real pleasure to be here. Good morning to everyone. Baptist Health is very proud to support the University of Miami and the Global Business Forum, and we're delighted to have been a sponsor of the keynote speech earlier today. As the largest not-for-profit healthcare organization in the region, Baptist Health has a responsibility to help shape the dialogue about the future of healthcare and to transform how we deliver healthcare to benefit patients and their families. We're a nationally award-winning employer with more than a dozen centers of excellence and an extensive reach throughout Latin America and the Caribbean. With partners like the University of Miami and other healthcare institutions in the region, we're dedicated to creating a healthier South Florida community. The Global Business Forum is a wonderful opportunity to bring together thought leaders on a topic of national importance. Our session this morning will feature a conversation between U.S. Food and Drug Administration Commissioner Margaret Hamburg and former Health and Human Services Secretary and prestigious University of Miami President Donna Shalala. You can applaud. So now to introduce, so everybody knows Donna, so she needs no introduction, but I would like to introduce the commissioner, Margaret Hamburg. She reminded me that she began her career in research, neuroscience research. She's a Harvard College graduate and a Harvard Medical College, Medical School graduate in internal medicine, and she did her internal medicine practice at New York Presbyterian, previously known Cornell Columbia, and so on. And so she has a very distinguished career as a medical doctor, scientist, and public health executive who brings together all these various experiences to craft public policy with years on hands-on research and patient care. As commissioner of the New York City Department of Health and Mental Hygiene, she improved services for women and introduced programs to reduce the spread of HIV and tuberculosis. She also initiated the first public health bioterrorism defense program for the United States of America. As Assistant Secretary for Policy and Evaluation in the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, she served with then HHS Secretary Donna Shalala, so these ladies have obviously a history together. Commissioner Hamburg's work has also focused on developing public health infrastructure and policy to deal with the post 9/11 threats for modern bioterrorism as well as naturally occurring infectious diseases. In 2009, President Obama appointed her as the 21st Commissioner of the U.S. Food and Drug Administration, which regulates, if you can believe this, over $1 trillion worth of consumer goods. Small job. Please, join me in welcoming Commissioner Hamburg and President Shalala to the stage.
I'll sit over here. Thank you very much, George, and thanks to Baptist Health, you and Brian Keeley and all your other colleagues that are here with us. I have spent much of my career trying to hire Dr. Hamburg. When we first got to Washington, I had, I guess I first met her in New York, because she spent much of her career in New York, and I think I offered her every job in HHS. But everybody will appreciate this. She had small children and a husband who worked in New York, and it was complicated. I begged her to take the CDC job at the beginning of the Clinton administration, and she just couldn't do it. And finally, I got her down to Washington, which wasn't too far from New York. We made her husband commute. To take the job as the senior policy person really in the department. As George indicated, she's a very distinguished scientist physician with training in the areas in which she has responsibility. And at HHS during my tenure, she had very broad responsibilities, including initiating some of the first work on bioterrorism. She is herself a world-class physician and scientist. She understands the science. FDA is a very difficult job. She's also the youngest person ever elected to the Institute of Medicine of the National Academy of Sciences. So we have with us a very special person and a very good friend, and I want to welcome her to the University of Miami. Thanks, Peggy. Thank you. Now, I also want to say that most of what I know about the areas that Peggy is responsible for, as well as bioterrorism, that she's a very good teacher. And so if you're a good HHS secretary, you hire first-class people and then you listen to them, and then you trot along beside them to try to implement and get some policies in the areas in which they make recommendations. And I'd like Dr. Hamburg to start by giving you a very good feel for the range of her current responsibilities. And then I want to ask her, hopefully, some straightforward questions about what she does and about the challenges of her job. Dr. Hamburg.
Well, thank you. And thank you for that wonderful introduction. And thank you for the friend and mentor that you've been over so many years. It's one thing to know a little bit about science or a little bit about medicine. But when you're working at a high level in government public service, it is important to know a lot about many other aspects of the work, not just politics, but that does matter, but management, organization, and most importantly, common sense. And Donna, through her leadership, taught me an awful lot about how to handle complex issues, how to handle complex interpersonal situations, and how to get things done. Most of all, as you all know that have had the opportunity to work with Donna, she knows how to get things done. So it's a pleasure to be here and wonderful to have a chance to talk about an agency that I care deeply about and an agency that I hope all of you care deeply about too, because whether you really know it or not, the FDA impacts your life every single day in profound ways in many cases, more superficial ways in others, but there is no one in this nation that is untouched by the work of FDA. We are a very unique and essential agency. We are a public health agency, science-based, science-driven, a regulatory agency, but at the end of the day, our mission and our focus and our efforts are all dedicated to promoting and protecting the health of the American people. You heard that we are responsible for regulating products that represent about a $1 trillion spent on consumer goods in this country. We're responsible for somewhere between 20 and 25% of every dollar that's spent on consumer goods. Our range of responsibilities is enormous. Drugs, medical devices, food, its safety and quality, cosmetics, dietary supplements, things that emit radiation, and now tobacco products as well. We are an agency that was developed over a century ago in response to concerns being raised about basically snake oil that was being sold and concerns about terrible practices in the food industry, particularly some of the practices that were described by Upton Sinclair in his novel, The Jungle. But Teddy Roosevelt founded our agency back in 1906, and we have been expanding ever since. And what was originally a very much a domestic focus for FDA now really must shift to a global focus as the world we live in becomes increasingly complex and globalized. And those of you who live in Miami, I think, understand this in very significant ways as a port city and a place of enormous global interchange and commerce, but we now are regulating products that are coming from all over the world, hundreds of countries, hundreds of thousands of manufacturers around the globe. So it's a very challenging time to sit as FDA commissioner, but a a very exciting opportunity and a role in an agency that makes a huge difference for the health, well-being, and safety of all Americans and citizens of the world more broadly.
Thank you. Let's start out by talking about food and food safety, because you talked a little about globalization. And the fact is that if we look in any of our refrigerators and our cupboards, that food came from all over the place. How does a relatively small agency set a tone for food safety? I saw a number the other day of the number of Americans that get sick from food. I mean, how do you do it? How do you think about how you're going to help to make the food safer that comes into the United States and already exists in the United States?
Well, it's an enormous ongoing challenge and one that requires true partnership across levels of government as well as with industry and consumers. We all have a role to play. I'm happy to be able to report that, in fact, our country has one of the safest food supplies in the world. Nonetheless, we still must recognize that one in six Americans get sick from a foodborne outbreak in the course of a year. Many people require hospitalization in the tens of thousands, and 3,000 people a year die. These are preventable deaths, and those numbers probably are low because we don't get a full accounting of the disease and even deaths associated with foodborne disease. So we can and should do better. And controlling foodborne outbreaks in a globalized world gets more and more complicated. When I arrived at FDA and saw some of the numbers, I was frankly astounded. I had no idea that 80% of the seafood that we eat in this country comes from outside our borders, that about 40%, 35 or 40% of the fresh fruit and produce that we eat comes from outside our borders, probably considerable. A component of that comes through the ports in this area. But it does create a huge new challenge where we have to recognize that the old model from back in 1906, where we would see a ship coming into port and we'd open up that barrel of molasses and make sure that it was, in fact, molasses and it wasn't adulterated in a way that might threaten health, that now we have to push back from the borders and really have a global presence in order to assure the safety of the food supply. It doesn't mean that we can ignore the borders, not at all. We do have very active screening programs at the border. I've had the opportunity to visit our offices here, and they are kept very, very busy. We've tried to bring new science and technology to how we do our border screening in terms of using sophisticated computer systems to really do our inspections in a risk-based way based on the type of commodity, the history of the producer, the importer, et cetera, and other conditions that might affect food safety and quality. But we also have to work in new partnerships with sister regulatory authorities around the world, sharing information as well as sharing best practices. We also have to work very, very closely with industry to make sure that they are responsible and accountable for every step in the supply chain of their products, and that we really have a recognition that with the growing complexity, we're introducing new points of opportunity for problems to arise, and that we have to really put in place the systems that target those points of vulnerability to shore them up, to prevent problems from happening in the first place. And just one last observation on this important issue of food safety. Last week, the president signed into law a new food safety bill, which was really historic. The first major change in FDA-related food law since the 30s, when another President Roosevelt, FDR, modernized aspects of the FDA legal regulatory framework. But it's really historic, and Congress is calling on FDA to put in place really a whole new approach to food safety based on prevention, a core principle of public health, and a very appropriate and necessary way to address food safety. Too much over the years. We have had a system that was based on trying to respond once a problem occurred and to move as quickly as possible to understand where the illness was coming from and to remediate it. But it's much more cost effective and much more valuable in terms of reducing unnecessary illness to try to identify the points of vulnerability ahead of time, address them, and prevent problems from happening in the first place. Yeah.
Some of the criticism of FDA always comes from the pharmaceutical industry that and the biotech industry that invests a lot of money in producing products. And of course, they want you to do a 24-hour turnaround on approving those products. You obviously can't do that, but it does get reflected in the cost of drugs and the cost of healthcare. What are the challenges to FDA, and how can you streamline the process? Talk a little about the new movement, I think, for clinical trials to go outside the country. How much of that can you look at? But you're really in a bind. I mean, you're caught between a rock and a hard place, because we've got a dynamic industry and then the challenges of making sure that those drugs are safe.
Well, it's a very complex set of questions and really important issues, and we could spend a whole day talking just on this topic alone. But it's a critical time. It's a critical time for the health of our country and for our healthcare system and also for our economic competitiveness in terms of the importance of the pharma and biotech sector for our nation and for our global economic competitiveness. And there's no doubt that FDA sits in a unique role. We sit in a unique role in terms of being a gateway, not a barrier, to innovation, to moving new discovery from the microscope to the marketplace, as Secretary Sebelius said. We also sit in a unique place in terms of being able to look in two directions, to be able to look out on one end and see the unmet public health need, on the other, what's in the pipeline of new discovery that could turn in to products. I see the FDA as really having to take on new leadership in an important aspect of the challenge of getting products to people, which is really to strengthen regulatory science. Because at the end of the day, if we're going to be able to recover the benefits of all of the extraordinary investments in biomedical research, we have to be more strategic in our research investments, to be honest. We can't just invest in biomedical research per se. We also have to invest in regulatory science. It's the critical, underdeveloped link in the chain of our scientific enterprise that enables us to fully achieve the fruits of opportunity in science and technology today. And by regulatory science, I mean the knowledge and tools that enable us to evaluate the safety, effectiveness, quality, and performance of medical products, and with respect to food, more safety and quality. But in the medical product area, this is really important, and it actually involves some of the most exciting and cutting edge science today. But without developing regulatory science, we will not fully develop the tools that we need to make progress real, using biomarkers to understand how to target therapies for subpopulations of responders or subpopulations who may suffer adverse effects from certain therapies, using various kinds of genetic markers to really usher in the era of personalized medicine, using markers preclinically to identify the drugs that in fact will fail because they will have toxicities that are unacceptable in human populations, so that we don't have to face the current situation, which is that about 90% of the drugs in development never make it fully to the marketplace because of problems. If we can identify drugs that fail early, it saves time, it saves money, and it saves preventable problems in the human clinical studies as well. As we look at advanced therapies like stem cells, we need not only to develop the science that underlies the opportunity, but we also have to make sure that we can turn those ideas into viable products that are stable and reproducible and delivered safely. We look at emerging technologies like nanotechnology that have huge opportunities in how we think about drug delivery, along with many other aspects of nanotechnology's use. We still need to better understand the safety issues around particularly chronic exposure, because these products will linger in the body. So we need to be, as we're developing the new ideas in the science, we need to be thinking about what are the regulatory questions as well, and developing that science simultaneously, developing new clinical trial analytics so that we can in fact get answers faster and more efficiently with fewer patients. And if we really can work together, strengthening science within FDA and developing the field of regulatory science more broadly, in partnership with great research universities like this one and with industry, we can streamline and modernize the regulatory pathway. We can really affect not just the regulatory process, which is a piece of the puzzle that you were describing at the beginning in terms of the time and money it takes to get a product to market, but we can also make the development process more efficient and targeted towards the end game, which is getting those products to people in the marketplace.
And that's really the business side of
right. And the truth is, you know, people think that FDA is the sole bottleneck in the process, but it's the whole development process, and we're actually seeing fewer applications coming to us now, mm-hmm. and that reflects the complexities of the development pipeline
and the expense of it,
as well as the need to modernize and streamline and clarify the regulatory process.
If we could stop for one moment. My 99-year-old mother is here, and she wanted to make sure we were speaking distinctly enough, so I want to ask her whether she can hear us. Are we doing okay? Yeah. She can hear us, okay. So let me ask the question in a different way. When I talked to you just after Barack Obama was elected, I was sort of stunned that you wanted to do the FDA job, because you've spent much of your career in public health and on the prevention side, even though you clearly had studied the science and done things at NIH. And in fact, we have extended life far more dramatically with clean water and clean air and some of those things. In some ways, the drug industry and the drugs we've introduced have had a more marginal effect. So why would a public health person want to do the FDA job?
Well, I have to say, it wasn't originally on my radar screen as a job, and it's one of those jobs that in a way you have to be crazy to do it, but I had taken on one of those jobs before at the New York City Department of Health and found it to be extremely gratifying and rewarding. And my feeling was this was really a critical time for the FDA. It was an agency that had been much beleaguered, chronically underfunded, and it has this important and unique mission, which I mentioned earlier, in terms of promoting and protecting health. And at the end of the day, it is a public health agency, and it really has not been appreciated in that context. And I came on board intending to run it as a public health agency, to always be thinking about and encouraging FDA employees across the span of our responsibilities to always be thinking about what is the public health outcome that we're trying to achieve. And it's been very exciting, and it goes to the core of the mission of FDA since its very founding, but it had gotten buried a bit, and I think that we have raised it again, and it makes a difference. And at the end of the day, we are involved in so many issues that directly impact on public health, importantly now including tobacco, which remains the leading cause of preventable illness and death in this country. And for the first time, we have the authority to regulate tobacco products and many aspects of the marketing of tobacco products, importantly to children and youth. And through our activities in that domain alone, we will have a huge and profound impact on public health.
So let me ask the question my Aunt Lou asked me to ask you. So she has some very expensive drugs, even with Part D. So why can't she just get them from Canada, where they're cheaper?
Well, that is a question I've been asked before.
You know my position on that.
You know, it's so much more complicated than it seems on the surface, and you really have to step back and look at the nature of the industry and the nature of how drugs are produced and made available around the world. And people look at Canada, which has a different system of healthcare, and they see that drugs that are the same brand names, the same manufacturers, are cheaper in Canada, and they say, why can't I just go over and get them in Canada? And in some instances, they are the same drugs. Sometimes they're slightly different formulations, which can be of concern in some types of disease conditions where it really does matter, you know, what the exact dosing you're getting in the formulation. But in a subset of instances, it all makes sense. But the scary thing is that a lot of drugs that one might think are coming from Canada, are coming from places all over the world. There are a zillion internet sites that you go on to. They advertise cheaper drugs from Canada. They have the Canadian maple leaf to verify that these, in fact, are Canadian drugs. You go to various ports of importation. I've spent time in New York City and down here at Port of Miami and other places, and you watch what's coming in, ordered over the internet, supposedly from Canada. The quality of these materials is so variable you can't believe it. Sometimes it's actual drug, but not the official drug that you think made by the manufacturer, but it has the actual active ingredients that you think you're ordering in that drug. Sometimes it's just talcum powder or something else. Some of the materials, you can't believe anyone would actually take them because they're so obviously counterfeit. But the real danger is that it's a very, very fluid world out there in terms of some of the products that are being introduced into the marketplace. If you are operating through a bona fide pharmacy, you can have a lot more confidence in what you're getting. But the real danger in going down that path is, especially through the internet, you have no idea what you're getting, where it comes from, and it can be dangerous to your health.
One of the things we should point out is you don't have full jurisdiction over everything that people suggest is a drug or a product, because healthcare stores and those kinds of things, you really don't have full jurisdiction over.
Absolutely. You know, one of the things that has been a real eye-opener for me at the FDA is that we regulate such a range of products, and the legal regulatory framework for different commodities is very different, and we have
and politically designed, basically.
And yes, you know, there are a very different set of rules that govern FDA oversight of dietary supplements versus pharmaceutical drugs, and it puts us in a different position in terms of our authorities. And one of the other extraordinary things is that we have much more limited authorities for mandatory recall of contaminated or adulterated products than the public generally thinks. And one of the great achievements of the new food safety law is that in the food area, it actually, for the first time, gives us the authority for mandatory recall.
Otherwise, you're just sort of nudging people or using publicity to sort of have them pull back. What about corporations' accountability in the whole system, particularly in the drug areas? How much authority do you have in those areas?
Well, you know, in both the drug arena and the food arena, you know, I'm really happy to be able to say that for the most part, companies take these responsibilities extremely seriously. It goes to the very core of their business in terms of brand names and products that people can trust, and the desire and performance in complying with standards is high. But problems do arise. There certainly are just outright bad actors in many realms. Other times, problems occur even with the best of intentions. And so it's very, very important that, number one, companies have systems in place to continually be monitoring and checking and assuring quality. A more complex job, but a more important job in a globalized world where supply chains are coming from all over. It's also very, very important that there be a working relationship and a real transparency of communication between industry and the FDA. And we have worked hard on our side to try to increase that, including a major transparency initiative with components targeted to different stakeholders. But we just announced 2 weeks ago a new phase in terms of industry-related concerns and really trying to make it easier and clearer what our expectations are and work more closely with industry. When there are problems with compliance, that's where some of the authorities and tools that we have aren't always as modern as I would hope, and I look forward to working with Congress in the drug area to do some of what's been achieved in the food safety area. But we often do have to enter into a negotiation that can be prolonged if the company doesn't take immediate action to get them to do certain things. We sometimes have to join with partners at the state level that may have authorities we don't have to take action, or through our partners in government, the Department of Justice, and the court system, we sometimes have to seek injunctions or other actions.
Yeah.
That's much harder, it takes longer, and in cases where there is a clear and present public health risk, you know, that is not the position that I think we should be in.
Could you explain a little the difference between your jurisdiction and the Department of Agriculture? You've got fish, they've got meat.
It's very confusing. The simplest explanation is that they have meat, poultry, and catfish.
Yeah.
That makes a lot of sense. The slightly snider explanation is that we have responsibility for oversight of 80% of the food supply. They have 20%, but they have 80% of the money, and we have 20% of the money. But it needs to be a close working relationship,
obviously,
and we have in areas that go beyond just the oversight of food.
Now, the reason they have 80% is they actually have lots more people that go out and actually look at the
meat. And it's interesting how things evolve over time. They have a very different model of inspection, and it's actually a requirement of the law that for meat packers, any time an operation is open for business, a USDA, Department of Agriculture inspector has to be present on site, whereas we do inspections episodically. And you know, there's differences of opinion about how well those different systems work. Some argue that, of course, it's better to have someone on site during all hours of operation overseeing what's going on. Others say that industry capture happens that way. You get too friendly, you're not really paying attention, you're schmoozing with the workers, et cetera. Our model is very different. You go in, you're looking for certain things, you do your job, you make your report, you take your actions, and move on to the next place. Clearly, in the world we live in, the model of USDA is not going to ever be transferred to FDA because it would be more money than our nation could ever afford. And one of the things we really have to work on going forward is how to make even our model of inspections more cost efficient. How can we bring the best science to bear so that we can do on-site laboratory diagnostic testing, not sending things off to the lab? How can we do risk-based inspections? It's a huge challenge, especially as we're thinking about not just all the facilities that manufacture drugs, devices, and food and other products in this country, but what's on the global scene as well.
I want to get to tobacco, but I'd like to, we had an earlier conversation about bioterrorism. And Dr. Hamburg, Commissioner Hamburg, is one of the experts in the world, really, on bioterrorism. And talk a little about your earlier work and about the shortcomings in our thinking. I mean, we've come a long way in our thinking about bioterrorism.
Well, you know, it's a topic that I certainly didn't learn about in medical school. It wasn't something that was really on my medical or scientific radar screen until I became health commissioner in New York City. And was there the first time that the World Trade Center was bombed. And I began to think very seriously about terrorism as a domestic threat and about the areas of responsibility that were under my leadership as health commissioner of the city, and realized that there were a set of issues I really needed to focus on. I also, as health commissioner, was dealing with a range of diseases and medical concerns that I'd never really thought about in my medical training. Because of New York being a hub for international travel, trade, and commerce, and I was seeing imported diseases appearing in our hospitals, sometimes causing outbreaks, and also experiencing the emergence of new naturally occurring infectious diseases that we hadn't really expected or thought about, HIV being, of course, foremost among those. When I started medical school, I actually was of that generation that was taught that the era of infectious diseases was more or less over, and the future of medicine was chronic disease, and then I watched the AIDS epidemic emerge and sadly take hold.
Smallpox come back.
So I really started thinking about biological threats in a very new way during that period and felt very strongly that there was a continuum of infectious disease threats that as a nation we weren't really prepared for, and that a critical component in our preparedness was to really rebuild the public health infrastructure that in recent decades had been allowed to decay. This was the era when the focus was really on building out the modern healthcare delivery system, and a tertiary hospital was much more important than a strong public health department. But for a healthy, secure nation, we need both. And so I had the opportunity when I went to HHS to really expand on a national level, work begun in New York City to rebuild public health, to recognize that public health is public safety, and that it needs to get the attention, the support, and the respect of other components of health and medical care, but importantly, of our broader concerns about national and international security. And as we dealt with the threat of pandemic flu last year, I think it was very obvious that public health and healthcare systems were at the forefront of efforts to respond and prepare. But everyone from the president on down understood that there were broader consequences of a biological threat, whether it be natural or deliberately caused, that go to the very heart of security. And so I think that this is a very important and
tell the story of the first time that you went to the White House in the Clinton administration.
Right. Well, when I arrived in the Department of Health and Human Services, thanks to then Secretary Shalala, My interest in bioterrorism really was viewed by many in the public health and medical field as almost part of the lunatic fringe. You know, a lot of people thought I was really kind of crazy. But I sat down and talked with Donna about it, and she got it. And not only did she get it, but she also saw it as a strategic opportunity to help build public health for the nation, which was key to get people to think differently about its importance and role. So she empowered me to begin to work to build a preparedness program for the department and for the nation. And so I inserted myself into a meeting at the White House on bioterrorism-related issues. This was before 9/11 and the anthrax letters, so it was still, even for security types, somewhat more remote. But I arrived, actually the head of management and budget, who was sponsoring the meeting, said to me, why is HHS here? You know, doesn't FBI and FEMA and DOD handle these issues? And I sort of explained why we had this important role and unique expertise to bring to bear. And then the FBI guy who was there piped up, and he said, well, you know, we really, you know, are on top of this issue, and we have the expertise, the capacity, and the experience. And, you know, if something happens, you know, we have the teams, we have the knowledge, and we will go in, we will defuse the pathogens. So I tried hard to keep a straight face, but I explained why that would be a challenge, and people got it.
I love that story. I love that story. Let me ask, if people have questions that you start, let's get the microphones up, and I'll start, Peggy, talking a little about tobacco, which is, it's a long time coming in terms of authority on tobacco. I actually sat down and read the legislation, you know, all about the different flavors of tobacco and how you handle menthol and all that. It's a very complex piece of legislation in terms of your authorities. You want to talk a little about how you're thinking about the implementation of these new authorities in tobacco? And anyone that wants to come up and ask questions, let me encourage people to come up.
Well, this is a very important piece of legislation. It was signed into law a year ago, summer, by President Obama. It was passed in a bipartisan way, wasn't unanimous support by any means, but it did reflect the culmination of many years of effort during Donna's tenure at HHS. There was, you know, an enormous effort mobilized to really look at how we could start to really regulate tobacco in new ways. It took some time to realize that vision. And it also, of course, this legislation reflected the fact that people understand the huge burden that tobacco has on this nation in terms of health and well-being, but also on our economy. The law gives us a very powerful set of new tools and authorities. It also lays out a set of tasks and requirements that are quite daunting, and we have been struggling every day to meet the statutory requirements of this bill, and so far we have. The first job was to stand up a whole new center and begin to build new infrastructure and capacity at FDA at the same time that we were beginning to implement the law. The key areas of focus of the new legislation have to do with enabling us for the first time to really examine tobacco products and the components of tobacco products to understand the underlying science and health risks involved. And that is huge, and it is now requiring us to build up that scientific capability and draw on expertise across the nation and around the world. But companies are reporting to us about the components of their products. And that is going to be very, very important in making decisions about how to reduce risk going forward. It also gives us authorities in terms of regulating the types of products and the marketing of products. One of the early actions required in the law had to do with the removal of candy-flavored and fruit-flavored cigarettes from the marketplace, and these, you know, really had been designed as a way of recruiting
kids
and new smokers into a lifelong addiction and habit of smoking. And I think this will make a difference in our smoking profile. It also has allowed restrictions on certain marketing practices, again, with a mind towards reducing the attraction of smoking to youth in particular, but also providing better information to current smokers. We recently announced that we would be introducing graphic warning labels on tobacco packages and tobacco advertising. The law was very prescriptive here. 50% of the tobacco package must contain a graphic warning, front and back. There are 9 different messages that the law told us they wanted us to use with respect to highlighting the risks of smoking. And the rest will be graphic warning labels. And we're currently testing a range of different images. And actually, you can go on to the web and look at them and make comment on our public docket about which ones you think are effective. But we want to target different populations with different kinds of images. But you will be seeing a real change in tobacco.
And this is an area where there's bipartisan support
to
move on tobacco, which is another example of where you can move a public health issue to tobacco.
Can we take some
questions? I don't know how much more time we have. No one's waving at me. So let's take up questions. The only thing you cannot ask, and I made my reputation protecting the FDA, is where a particular drug is in the approval process. So.
Well, I'm not going to ask about that, and I certainly appreciate your insights. I want to ask you some questions about generics. Obviously, we're all concerned about cost control, and this is one mechanism for cost control. As a neurologist who for many years has been focused on seizure disorders, I want complete control in my patients. And one of the issues that many of us have is whether treating seizures with generic medications is effective. And as we switch, we see reemergence of seizures with all of the attendant complications, et cetera. And I know that this is also the case with other medications. I'm wondering if you can comment in terms of anti-seizure medication and generics, because I see this as a very specific problem and concern.
Maybe too specific.
Yeah, well, and this is a question that has been brought up with me before, and I have spent time with colleagues in the neurology field, because it is a concern that's very prevalent. Generic review is done in a very systematic way with requirements, for the substitutability of a generic product for an innovator product. In all manufacturing, there is some variability between lots of an innovator product, between lots of a generic product. But we have standards and requirements that are closely adhered to. On the other hand, when practitioners, such as presumably yourself, and societies representing an area of practice consistently raise a concern, we have to take it seriously. And it's a question where science can get us better answers. We're working with NIH to move forward on doing some studies that will specifically ask and answer some of the questions that have been raised about substitutability and crossover. And I think it's very, very important that we continue to build the science base of understanding for these kinds of questions. But I do want to underscore, you know, that generics are, you know, carefully reviewed and monitored, that their standards for substitutability are taken, you know, very, very seriously. And we have a life cycle approach to the products that we regulate. And so just because you get approved as a generic doesn't mean that if issues are raised, we don't examine them and address them and potentially take action. Just as with innovator drugs as well, we all know that when a drug is in practice, when more people are using it, you may see safety concerns in use that you couldn't see in the study populations. And so FDA in recent years is putting a much stronger emphasis on post-marketing surveillance of innovator drugs and generic drugs, following up on safety signals or other questions that emerge, and undertaking the science necessary to get the answers that right. we need.
Is there a question over here?
Thanks yes. very much.
Yeah.
I just had a question about the FDA's role relative to food additives and preservatives. I mean, obviously, obesity is a huge issue in this country and a huge healthcare expense for us. You know, this generation of adolescents are dealing with adult onset diabetes for the first time we're seeing it in children. So, you know, what would be the role that you would see the FDA having relative to those additives, preservatives, and its impact on the health of the population in this country?
Well, it's a very, very important set of questions, and actually food additives goes back to the very founding of FDA in terms of our responsibilities with the Pure Food and Drug Act in 1906. It's an area that I think FDA as an agency and more broadly the scientific community really needs to study in a more focused way and with the most modern science and technology in terms of some of the types of exposures. It's food additives, it's environmental exposures and toxins. I think that, you know, we're sort of on the threshold of a new set of understandings about some of these materials and their potential health impacts. And it's understudied and underdeveloped. It's one of the areas of regulatory science that FDA is putting renewed emphasis on. I think it's very, very important. You know, and frankly, you know, one of my my duties in this role is to try to, when I'm in a setting like this, recruit as much help as I can to address serious issues. And I think, you know, that this is one of the domains of research that we really need to put more focused effort into, bringing together the brightest minds from academia, industry, and government.
Let's take a final question from a student.
Hi, thank you, Dr. Hamburg, Dr. Shalala. As we know, there are many ways to increase the quality of the food supply, but which one you think is the most efficient way to increase the food supply currently for the US? And is there anything that must do to increase the food supply?
Well, there are two important aspects of the food supply. There's both the safety of the food supply and the availability of the food supply. And I'm not sure if you were asking
The quality.
Quality, okay. You know, as the food production systems get more complicated and more food is processed and has a complex life cycle from the basic components through to a manufactured product, there are more and more steps where problems can arise, where contamination can be inadvertently introduced, where food additives can be introduced. And so I think, you know, the critical thing is whether it's you know, a farmer bringing food to market, or a product being grown and then processed and distributed and then coming to the shelf, is that the companies that understand their products, working with the FDA and our regulatory experts and scientists, need to look at the points of vulnerability, as I was saying before, and really address them. And you know, there's a lot of commonality, but I think what is key and what's so exciting about where we are now with this new food safety legislation is that we really have the mandate to think differently about food safety and to put the emphasis on prevention rather than monitoring and looking for problems and then addressing them. And so I think if there was one focus that I think is important, it's the emphasis on prevention.
Yeah. Please join me in thanking Commissioner Hamburg for an extraordinary presentation. That was really great.
Thank you.
Great.